I left my family. I left my kids. I left my nightclubs, my parking company, $35 million to fight the fight.
And we're live. This is a another edition of the Patreon-only caller Q&A here with John. So we want to thank all of you loyal Patreon subscribers. If you are watching this on YouTube, as we're going to post this on YouTube, and you want to become part of that Patreon family, please join us by going to patreon.com/mafiatruths with John Elite. They have a great app so you can watch everything. We post all our content early there, bonus content, and of course the option and ability to call into the show, talk to us directly, all that good stuff. So go check that out and let's get into it. Let's call our Patreon members. Some aren't available at this time, so they've just left their questions, but lots of good stuff to get into.
Hello.
Hello, Zach. This is Felix and John Alight. How are you?
Oh, what's up, boys?
How are you doing, Zach?
No, not doing too bad. Yourself?
Well, pretty good now. Got a new ticker.
Good deal. So,
well, first,
I just got one question for you guys. You know, you guys were, John, you were around a long time and sat down with a lot of guys. And I'm just curious, did you ever sit down with little Nicky Scarfo? And what was he like to be around?
Nicky Scarfo used to stay in a club out in South Jersey in Atlantic City. Jerry Blavitt, there was another club next door to that, Jerry Blavitt. So his whole crew would go in. I was a young guy. I was states with some of the younger guys back in those days that were part of Nicky's crew. Actually, we're still friends from back then, a couple of those guys. And yeah, I met him. Didn't know him well, obviously, but I stayed in their company a couple of times while everybody was drinking and have a good time down there. So, I mean, he was a wild guy for sure. Probably one of the wild, most wild guys in any state or city in the mob.
Mm. Oh, very cool. Very cool. Go ahead.
No, Zach, I mean, what? Tell us a little bit about you. We want to thank you for subscribing to Patreon. I know you're a recent subscriber, but we're interested to find out a little more about you. And obviously, if you have any other questions for John, shoot away.
Oh, no, just interested in all the mob stuff. And you guys, I do a lot of driving for work, so I put your guys' podcast on in the car when I'm driving, and it helps pass the time, so I love it.
Yeah, I appreciate it. And, you know, Zach, I don't know if you know, if you're aware of this, but I live in New York, but I also had houses down in South Jersey. So I was very friendly with guys in my new book, Ronnie Turchi. His son did a couple chapters about the relationship between I had with him and his father, who was a one-time concierge of the family. I was friends with Angelo Bruno's grandson. So there's a couple of guys that were involved with me from down there that... you know, so I had some mutual friends from both families, the Gambino family and the Philadelphia mob. So I've got a lot of relationships down there over the years. And I'm not sure where you're from. Where are you from?
Washington State, Spokane, Washington.
Okay.
Yeah, a long ways away.
Yeah, yeah. I was wondering why you asked, but I thought maybe you hung out at Touche's back in the day when everybody was there, or Blavitt's place and some other, you know, places back in those days, the clubs. In that area, Cherry Hill area, was Enchante, you know, so there was some other clubs that everybody would go to, those guys would go to.
All right. Well, sweet. Thanks, guys. I appreciate the call, and keep doing what you're doing. I love the show.
Thank you. We appreciate
really
that. Thank
appreciate
you, Zach.
The call. Thank you.
No problem. Have a good one, guys.
Take care.
All right, guys.
Hello, this is Matt.
Hey, Matthew, this is Felix and John Alight. How are you?
Hey, Matt.
Hey, man, I'm doing great. How are you?
Good, Matt. How's things? Everything's good with you?
Oh, wow. Yeah, everything's great, man.
Good.
Great. Sorry, you guys. I couldn't believe you guys were going to call me. That's awesome.
We only called you because your name's Matt, same as my father and son, so we chose you.
Yeah. Yeah, I know. I remember that from the couple documentaries. Yeah.
Where are you from, Matt?
I'm from California, San Francisco.
Oh, okay.
You know, we're, I live about, I don't know, we're considered the Bay Area.
Okay.
About 30, 40 miles north of San Francisco.
Are you near Pelosi's house by any chance?
Oh.
Nancy Pelosi, you know who that is?
John's favorite. House?
No, I don't know who that is. Who is it?
Well, I was going to say go over and get ice cream because she's got a refrigerator full of ice cream. She's just a political figure.
Oh, okay, okay. I try to stay out of the politics.
Yeah,
yeah.
I've been advised the same thing.
Yeah, I'm sure you guys get sucked into it sometimes.
I wanted to say throw a rock, but I didn't do that. I bit my tongue. I said go get ice cream.
Anyways, Matt,
I'm gonna do that. It's got to be late night.
Yeah.
First of all, I want to thank you for being a subscriber of the Patreon. I know you're brand new, so welcome.
Yeah, thank you.
You left us. You wrote a couple questions, but I'll have you ask them to John directly.
Sure.
The floor is yours.
Sure. All right. So, I've wanted to ask you a lot of questions, John, because I've read your book. I've listened to a lot of documentaries. Your story is really fascinating. First of all, you know, congratulations to you for coming out of that life. That's great, and what you're trying to do for the kids. That's awesome. The Jimmy Calandra, I don't know if I'm saying his name right.
Right.
How do you say his last?
Jimmy Calandra? Calandria.
Calandria, yeah. I remember seeing him on a documentary a long time ago, some Bass Street Crew or something. And
Backstreet
Boys?
In fact,
no. Yeah, no.
I don't think
that's what I think, man.
I really don't think he can say his own last name. He's not that intelligent, but go ahead. Let me. Yeah.
But so this is crazy, man. This morning he just posted another one calling you John A Liar and calling out Larry
Mazza
again.
Yeah.
And I just, you know, well, I don't know. Well, what is he doing? Why is he trying to tarnish everything that you guys are talking about?
Well,
and what's his story? Do you know him? He says he was in prison with you.
Yeah, yeah. So, well, you know what we're going to do? I'm going to answer him today for everybody, right? I'm going to do a little skit show on him in a little bit. And then I won't bring it up, but here's what I'll tell you about the guy. And, you know, when people change their life, right, including myself, it's not my words that are going to make you believe me. It's my actions. So when I decided to change my life, I get, and I'm very friendly with very, very serious group of guys that are ex-killers. Not guys that I know that aren't. They were my enemies at one time, and now they became very, very close to me, like almost like brothers to me. And they moved on with their lives, and I moved on with mine. We all met with each other. We discussed it, and they're successful guys. They're gentlemen. They're fathers. So we all look at life the same way. But when you have a guy like Jimmy that, you know, he's talking one thing and he's behaving in a different way, there's 3 points to making any of these guys good gangsters and gentlemen now, and that's intelligence, number one. And Jimmy doesn't have any of that. He's not educated. He's not street educated. So if anybody listens to him speak or, you know, converse, you're obvious that you can see that he's not an educated guy. Two is somebody that's successful, whether you're on the street back then or you reinvented yourself now like most of us have done, and we're all successful. He's still penniless then, and he's penniless now. And the third thing is he's not a killer. So he's telling people he's a killer. And one of the reasons I think he's mad is he wanted to be on my show. And I didn't want to have him here because he at one time killed a housewife and a woman. So when someone
does
that.
Yeah, I heard that story, yeah.
And, you know, he talks about, you know, he's religious and God, and, you know, he doesn't repent. He doesn't say he's sorry. Instead, he's worried about me taking a picture with one of his old friends that supposedly killed one of his other friends. Now, he had 30 years to go kill the guy. He never did. So that's first thing. But when that life is over for us, we all move on. And by my actions, people could see I'm very good friends, almost brothers, with the guys that used to want to kill me. We went back and forth at each other. We hurt each other. We killed each other. Different guys got killed in our little war. But we all decided to change our lives. And these are real guys. These aren't like Jimmy guys that are fake. So when we decided to do that, we all did that. So when a guy says to me, why am I taking a picture with one of his old enemies? And my answer to that is, well, your old enemies were supposed to be left behind when you became an informant, when you cooperated. So if that's not what you wanted for your life, then you shouldn't have cooperated. You shouldn't have ratted, whatever word you want to use. And
yeah. You're
not going to influence me to go after one of your old enemies because I like the guy. And whatever happened
right.
in your past doesn't matter to me. I talk to guys that have testified against me. I says, and the reason why I do that is because people know I'm real when I change my life. And as far as Jimmy, I don't pay him too much mind. And, you know, you guys know I'm pretty, you know, famous around different countries, this country. You know, we got books out, movies out, documentaries
sure.
out. So I guess he wants a little attention. So he started coming after me and certain one of my friends like Larry Mazza. And for the people that don't know, Larry Mazza and about 24 of us are very good friends, all of us. We all respect each other. We all reinvented ourselves. We're all, you know, doing well financially, and we became, you know, we're generous.
Right.
So we don't even want to do this. We'd hate to even go back at this kid, but I think we have no choice. And to explain to some of you guys like I just did.
Correct.
If you want to be a gangster, then stop fronting and go out there and be a gangster. But your resume speaks for itself, and my resume of how I changed my life speaks for itself, and the Forbes article, for people that don't know or don't want to believe or don't know what's true or isn't, read Forbes magazine. They did a 40-page article on me, and it was reaffirmed by the author, by the magazine, by the prosecutors and FBI agents all involved in our lives. So they know what's accurate and what isn't, and it's Forbes is not some you know, star magazine. It's one of the best magazines in the country. So I, you know, advise people to read that and come up with their own conclusion of, I'm not going to play this childish, ignorant game that this kid's playing.
Now, do you guys think that he's a puppet for John Gotti Jr.?
Nah, listen, sometimes, you know, there's things I don't like about John. And then there's things I think John's a little more of a gentleman than some guys. He never killed any woman. He never asked anybody to kill a woman. His father never killed any woman. So, you know, I got to be real. John's a good father. You know, this kid has problems. Yeah. Jimmy's complete opposite. The guys that put their hand out for him to help him, he tried to sleep with their wives. I have text messages. I'm going to put them on my show for people to see what he said to a friend of mine who actually helped him and tried to give him a living and make him a living. Instead, he tried to sleep with his wife. And then he also tried to sleep with my friend Michael's wife. And Michael, we have those text messages. So it's not just verbal. We have, you know, obviously what I'm saying, it doesn't take a genius to see that if you change your life, you wouldn't be talking like this. But the other part of Jimmy and changing his life is he doesn't know how to reinvent himself. So the only thing he can do for a little popularity is talk about guys like myself and Larry.
And Larry.
And my friend Sal, I just talked about Michael. And he's not a killer. I mean, so when everybody looks at what he's ever done, he's not that. He's not a moneymaker, and he's not respected by any of us guys. There's 24 of us that have stayed friends from every family, every crew that changed their lives. So when people look into that and say, what's the reason for that? Then I guess he's got to answer that question. And same thing in prison. The guy PC'd himself when we were in jail. Listen, and I'm not trying to go at the guy. I have to answer this because people really don't understand what's going on. So if he wants to be a killer, then he should have killed Joey. But, you know, and I'm not trying to instigate Joey because Joey's a tough guy. And Joey wants to move on with his life. So, you know, you had 30 years to go after Joey if that's what you wanted. And the kicker of it is he's on Joey's Instagram liking all his pictures. So what is he trying to convey? I think it's just trying to get attention, and he's getting some. And I think that's what he's trying to get. You know, he's trying to get some attention off this, but in a negative way. And it's, you know, and we need to obviously talk about what he's doing.
Yeah. You know, John, sorry, I just got interrupted.
That's all right.
But one more thing. I know, you know, are you and Sammy going to do something together? And I know you had talked about a while ago, there was an interview when Sammy got out of prison. And, you know, I think you even brought it up on the site a little while ago on one of your talks that you guys were going to air that. Is that something that's still in the works? And are you and Sammy, you know, getting together? Is that in the works?
Well, there's a tape Sammy did when he first came out of prison. His first interview with anybody was with the guy that did Perfect Gangster About Me. It's a 40-minute audio interview that we're going to put out, and we're going to put it out on Patreon for our fans on Patreon and supporters on Patreon. So people will see exactly what Sammy had to say. But I was going to do something with Sammy, and we talked about it. And to be honest with you, I was disappointed that he put Jimmy on his show. Jimmy wanted to be
on. Yeah, I saw that too.
Well, I'm going to tell you why he did it. And for people that are, you know, again, that are intelligent, he put him on the show to embarrass him, to treat him like a little puppy, to show people the control he has. And I was disappointed that Sammy would do that and put Jimmy on there to show people that he had the authority, and look at the way this kid's rolling over for him on the show. Now, me, I wouldn't put Jimmy on the show. He asked to come on the show. Several times he asked, he talked to Gene. Gene was trying to convince me to put him on the show when Gene was on the show before he got jammed up. And I said I didn't want him on the show because he killed a woman and he hasn't really apologized publicly. He hasn't changed his life. He's still out there getting drunk and doing drugs and whatever else he's doing. So he's not fitting where me and Felix are doing these shows, and we're trying to send a positive message of changing your life, not by my words, but by my actions, the people I stay with, the people I talk to, and to forgive the people that try to take my life. And the people that try to take my life also forgive me. So if we're all men enough to move on and he's not, well, we got to leave him behind. And if he
leave him be.
Yeah, so,
leave
and that's where I'm in. And he's trying to, I guess, pull on our tail of our shirt and try to get us to react. And I'm not going to react like he does, like a child and a kid. And again, when you can't reinvent yourself because you're not capable to make money, you know, I'm sorry for you, but you need to go fix yourself somehow. And, you know, and I'm not going to fall to that level.
Gotcha. You know, it's when you put that book out, Gotti's Rules, you know, I'd always, you know, watch documentaries, read books, whether it was Lucky Luciano, Al Capone, you know, the mob in that life always kind of fascinated me. I'm not anything like that, but I always had an interest in it. I've read a lot of books on it. And I remember watching that 60 minute that Gotti Jr. did, and he called you like a vagrant, a junk pile, or I don't know what, something like that.
Even I laughed, yeah. and I was eating popcorn watching it.
Yeah, and I'm going, right? So I didn't even know who this guy was. And then when your book came out, I'm like, my whole view of all that was just like spun around, and I'm going, who is this guy? So I really got fascinated with finding out who you were, what you were about. A friend of mine was going to Mexico, and he's going, hey, man, I like to lay by the pool. Do you know a good book I can read? I go, I got the perfect book for you. So he read Gotti's Rules by the book, and he comes back, and he's going, man, I had no idea this was like this. And I go, yeah. And I kind of turned him on to some other things. And yeah, it was great that you came out to really, you know, to show how that life was and how treacherous it was and just how you really didn't have any friends and everyone's just turning on each other. And, you know, to public like me, you don't see any of that. You don't really know that's what it's like.
Well, I got a good friend of mine, Steve, and he called me when, you know, these things are occurring. You got to remember our comfort zone, all of us, I'm talking about all the guys that were ex-gangsters. Our comfort zone is we're educated from the street. So our reaction is from the street. That's where we're comfortable. So when guys are pushing our button, the first thing we want to do is be aggressive. And the things that we learn through therapy, through changing your life, is don't react on your first reaction. And you try to talk like a gentleman. And people ask me all the time, why do I have Felix as my co-host, not another gangster? Because my example is Felix. My example is you, yourself, and regular people that live a good life, and conducive to society, enjoying life, enjoying the world. And you know, so for me, when guys ask me, what do I look up to? I look up to young guys like yourself. I don't need to be somebody that's trying to impress these guys on the street anymore. That was a negative way to impress. So when I'm talking to guys and they ask me, how are you going to react to this? I'm going to react to it like this. The same I did with Gotti. And, you know, me and Gotti could go back and forth forever. And, you know, the problem is people in public don't know who to believe or what to believe. And I don't, you know, because they don't understand. And they're never going to understand the history because of the treachery. So the life is no different. It's still very treacherous for us without us using violence. And, you know, and you got to either be intelligent enough to combat it like I do now. And I tell people, well, if you don't believe me, go read Forbes magazine, because that's a fact check magazine article, 40 pages about me. So it's not me writing about my own opinion. It's the government, the FBI, all were interviewed with the magazine editor and the author of that magazine, Richard Baja, who's a, you know, a award-winning writer. So you're not talking about anybody who I had a relationship with. This is, you know,
right,
third-party people speaking about facts. Now, I can't combat every time somebody talks about me. I'd be an imbecile to do it anyway. You know, people are going to say things whether they like me or not. And, you know, and people watch me on Patreon and people watch my shows or watch whatever movies I've done. And I've got several coming out, a new book coming out. Mafia International is out right now. And I say, maybe you don't like the way I speak or the way I come across, but another person likes the way my friend Larry speaks, or the way my friend Sal speaks, or the way my friend Anthony Aralata speaks, or Bobby Luiz. I encourage people to listen to these guys, or Anthony Ruggiano, who's my personal friend, whose father was the major boss around the area under Albert Anastasia. He has no reason to lie about me. If he didn't know me since I'm a baby, he tells everybody, listen, I've been in and out of his house since a baby. I was raised in this life since I'm a little kid. So, you know, when people saying, oh, he's a liar and he's this and that, I can't stop them. And sometimes I get mad. I mean, I'm a human being. Nobody likes anybody throwing rocks at him. But, you know, at the end of the day, I step back and I take a different perspective and I say, you know what? People that are intelligent, they'll know. They'll figure it out. And I leave it to you guys to figure out, you know, the way I carry myself and my actions, not my words, because my actions are speaking for what I do. My actions of talking to people that testified against me, obviously, I changed my life. If I wanted to be like Jimmy Calandra, I'd have to kill 40 or 50 guys that testified against me or guys that did things against me or try to kill me. Instead, we eat dinner together, those guys, because I got a very mutual respect with them like they have for me. Our war is over. We moved on with our lives. People that don't like that, I'm sorry to disappoint you, but they're gentlemen, they're successful. And guys like Tabita, people know who I'm talking about, is my personal brother, man. He's my friend. So I'm not going to be like Jimmy and talk that hatred and nonsense. That's somebody who's a failure, somebody that can't change his life and somebody doesn't make 2 cents. And, you know, it's the best way I can convey it to anybody.
Right, right. There's also another guy I was listening to, Anthony S. Luciano Ramondi. Do you know anything about him?
I don't know Anthony well, but yeah, I know some of my people that know him. And, you know, I don't really listen to anything he says. And I mean, I don't know what his message is. You know, my message is to the young guys, you know, go find something else to do for a higher adrenaline rush. Don't follow our old life because there's nothing. Look at the misery now. Just with this little nonsense with this kid, with Jimmy. It's just not worth the nonsense. If somebody asked him, why does he keep attacking? He doesn't have an answer. His answer was, I took a picture with a guy he never liked. That's the most ridiculous thing I ever heard. Yeah. So if you're going to judge somebody that killed your friend, how about we all judge you? You killed that woman. She wasn't a gangster. She didn't choose. She wasn't selling drugs. She was a legitimate housewife, woman, mother to kids. And he should be ashamed of himself. And that's what he should be dedicating his life to, apologizing for that. You know, what I apologize for killing gangsters. And, you know, and I'm the first guy that says we're all knuckleheads, all of us. So, you know, my message is very clear. And you know, the way I behave, I'm not attacking him or trying to go get him physically like I would have done in the past. I wouldn't be talking. We would just go find him. So, you know, at this stage of the game, he's just trying to get likes, I guess. I don't know. I mean, really, I can't figure out a guy that doesn't make sense. So, you know, if somebody can make sense of how he started this, then I'll know. But I'll tell you what, when he's talking about Larry Mazza, the guy's a gentleman. The guy's educated. The guy's married. He's got a life. This guy doesn't seem to have a life. So there's where his misery is.
And you can tell. You can tell people like Jimmy because, you know, when he does those interviews, not even an interview, it's just him with his phone or a computer just speaking. Nobody's questioning him. There's it's just him saying whatever he's saying, right? And you could tell by looking in his eyes. His eyes are always squinted like, I don't know if he's high or I don't know. He just, I don't know. He's not believable, but.
Well, you know, people that want to believe him are going to believe him. I mean, I guess. I mean, that's why I try to be fact-based. I tell people, don't believe me. Go get documents. Go read my, again, I could say it over again. You're like, I just repeat it. Go get Forbes. And, you know, contact the guy that wrote the article. I didn't know him. He called me. He asked if he could interview me. I didn't know where he was getting at. He interviewed me. He interviewed Gotti. I mean, it's fact based by all the prosecutors and FBI. There's no in between there. Those aren't my opinions. Those are facts that were, you know, founded by all the government people and ex gangsters.
Yeah.
People like to people like to be jealous. I mean, that's just part of life, you know, and not just in our field, but in any field.
Any field, yeah. Even my field, yeah. Mm-hmm. That's how it goes. Do you guys see Gene coming back anytime soon?
Gene, for the people on Patreon besides yourself, will be home next week. And again, I grew up with his family, so we have a good relationship. Gene's doing good. And, you know, he's not going to be in on any shows or anything like that because of his situation, parole. But the family's very close to me, so that's never going to change.
Nice.
But I appreciate your call, Matt. Really do. And you seem like a nice guy, gentleman, and educated. So, and you know, that's what we're aiming at towards people like yourself, girl, guy, parents, somebody really wants to know the truth about the life and what goes on even today with the life.
Yeah. Well, I appreciate you guys calling me, man. This is great. I never thought I'd hear from You or Felix. I watch a lot of your guys' interviews, man. My wife's like, what's the matter with you? And I go, I don't know. I just...
You want to hear something funny? A guy wrote me the other day, and he says, you know, he bought one of our bats. That, you know, I was, I don't know how much you know about that. I had a full ride scholarship in baseball.
And yeah, Florida, so, right? Yeah, and yeah, then you got that disease or whatever, right? You couldn't throw anymore.
Yeah, at the Tommy John surgery, and wasn't successful back in those days anyway. But the guy that was watching all the time, so his wife started writing, and he wrote, and he said that my wife said the bat that he bought, he's going to hit her with. She's going to hit him with. You know, joking around. So I thought it was funny, you know. So, and a lot of people think I'm selling these bats from me hitting people with bats. I mean, I guess if they want to think of it that way, but it was over my baseball career, and that's where this.
No, I know, and you have to read that book to understand that, you know. And I mean, you talk about that.
Well, Lou Romano just wrote my newest one called Mafia International, and I tell people that, you know, if they get that book, I want their opinion after they read it. Because it dives into international stuff and some of the prisons and some of the people are involved with from different crews and families that I'm still friendly with.
Is that book out? Is it available now?
Yeah, it's on my website.
JohnAlight.com, if the pre-order. So it'll take a little bit of time, and we're doing signed copies, whatever you choose. So yeah, you can go get it directly there.
Excellent.
All right, Matt. Excellent. Thanks for calling. I really appreciate it.
Hey, thank you, man.
If you want any contact, stay in touch. And
yeah,
let us know.
We'll get you on. We're going to try to do these. Usually we've been doing, I know you've been only subscribed for about 10 days, but in the past we've just done kind of had people write in their questions. But I think this is far more fun, and it's really cool to get to talk to great people like yourself. So we're going to try to do these monthly. So we hope to get you on the next one.
Yeah, that'd be great, man. I know it seems like I'm new to that site, but you guys have been posting this stuff on Facebook, and I've been watching it since the beginning.
Amazing. Well, we appreciate your support.
Thanks, Matt.
All right, you guys. Have a good day. Take care. And right. Take care of yourself.
Take care.
Enjoy your week.
Bye.
All right.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
This is Frank.
Hello.
Hello, Frank. This is Felix and John Aylett. How are you?
How you doing, Felix? Hey, Johnny.
Hey, Frank. How's everything?
Yeah, very good. I just want to say, Felix, you do a great job. You have a great future ahead of you with, you know, being a broadcaster or interviewer. You're very good at what you do.
Hey, I really appreciate that. Thank you so much.
Yeah, you're definitely very good. Job would give him some accolades, you know what I mean? He's very good at what he does.
Well, Frank, really, I tell him all the time, you better not leave me behind.
Yeah, no, I don't know when you got him, John, but I mean, he really, out of all the podcasts, you're very like mellow. You're very professional. You're very good at it. You really are.
Thank
smokes
you so
a
much.
Lot of weed too.
You know? I've never smoked weed.
Yeah, like hey John, just a little funny thing. If Felix was in the mafia, what would he be like? Good at, like, what would he be his thing?
Maya Lansky, he's smart.
Yeah. I can see him doing sit downs, being real calm.
He's my personal concierge. He tells me everything.
Yeah. You can set up for sit downs. Listen, this is how it's gonna go. Okay, everything's fine. You know, now John, I don't want to get in between, you know, what's going on with, I'll just say his initials. I'm sure you know what's going on with him, right?
Yeah. We just answered that.
Today's video, John, not for nothing, man. That was, if you, I'm not saying what he says, I don't even want to repeat it. It's a real low blow, bro. It's bad what he said, man.
Yeah, I don't even, listen, you know what I'm going to do, Frank?
You know?
Just what you said, right? Guys are going to suffer for what it is. Guys aren't stupid. He's got an agenda, and he's up
yeah, no, it's all about to, making money, right, getting fans, right, and everything. I understand that, but
I know what he's doing.
Just, what he said, if you, I don't know if you saw it. I mean, John, I don't even want to repeat it, John.
Yeah, I didn't even know.
It was really
you
amazing.
You could tell me. I mean, I don't care.
I won't listen
to it anyway. But
I mean, if I say it, I don't want nobody. He ain't gonna do nothing to me, right, or nothing. You know what I mean? Like,
listen,
you know,
the only thing he ever killed, honestly, and I just said it to the last caller, was a woman. That's the only person he ever killed. He killed a housewife and a
basically he used the word lowlife a lot, which I have a standing. When someone, I heard a guy call me a lowlife, I used to be in construction and I beat the shit out of him. You don't call somebody a lowlife, you know what I mean?
But you know what I said, Frank? You know, he's trying to trigger me. He's trying to make me be somebody.
That's why. But what I'm about to tell you.
That ain't going to work with me. This is basically
what he said, and I don't even want to repeat it, but I'm going to say it. He says that, when your father shot his load, instead of shooting it into your mother, you should have shot it in the toilet bowl. I mean, give me a break, man. that that's that's all called for. I mean, yeah. Jesus Christ.
What can I tell you?
I mean, the thing is, I'm a fan of all the, like all you guys. Like, right. You're my favorite, but I watch Sammy. I watch Jimmy. Jimmy gives good stories. You know, I like Larry. I just saw part one with Larry, and you called it in part two at 5:30. So. But, you know,
thanks for letting me know that. I didn't even know when it was. It's at 5:30.
I mean, God, how do you say that to somebody? I mean, I've never done it. You can't get more lower than that. Jesus Christ.
Frank, you know what? People listen. And I just said it in a kind way to the last caller for the last like 10 minutes.
Yeah.
I says people that have the insecurities that need to attack somebody else to get the attention and not get it on his own merits is speaks for itself. I'm not going to go back and forth with this kid like a little kid.
No, I just, and he also
no,
said
and
that.
I appreciate you saying it. And I'm going
to
tell you something.
This guy's not coming after me, right? I have to delete his webpage, his Facebook page.
No.
I mean,
he couldn't even.
I mean, I'm a fan.
Listen, Frank.
I'm a fan of everybody.
If you tell him where you live, he's too stupid to find the address. Trust me.
Yeah,
this guy ain't the brightest. He ain't the brightest bulb.
He also said that they take one of your signed baseball bats and you should get hit over the head with your signed baseball bat. I wouldn't fuck with you. So I don't know. He's great. I mean,
listen, could I tell you something? I changed my life. He could talk like that all he wants.
No, I know. People put you down, and I think you do a good job. You tell war stories. You know, I'm a recovering alcoholic. You tell war stories, but you also send a message that you are helping people. You know what I mean? I don't know what these guys are doing. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I don't really,
you know, the interest of people, they want to hear the stories. People ask, people write us, people send messages, people send emails, and we answer what everybody does. We try to, but the one thing we all discussed is our message is going to stay in a positive way. I'm not going to go back and forth and tell people what I would have did to them before and all that. It's nonsense. It doesn't matter.
Yeah.
And, you know, the thing I tell everybody, just like I told the last caller, let his intelligence let people judge for themselves. But we're not going to say anything negative.
Yeah. I mean, like, you don't know who to believe. You guys all, you know, you're the last of the guys that could tell the stories. Everybody else is dead. You know what I'm saying?
Well, you know
guys
what?
Are like
Frank,
the last of the generation.
I just told the last caller, and if you haven't done it, I would read Forbes magazine and put it in Google, put my name in, and you'll...
No, I look.
I'm just saying for accuracy of who you can believe and who you can't believe.
No, I believe the guy. Like I said, like I even don't get mad at me. I even enjoy that idiot that talks all about all you guys. I don't want to say his name. You had a problem with him. He's entertaining, but he's a little nutty too. You know what I'm saying? He I don't want to say his name.
Oh,
you know
I know what you're talking about.
Yeah, he's entertaining. You know, he's a smart guy, but he's got a beef with you too. That he calls all the rats are fighting with each other and killed each other. He's getting off on it. You know what I mean? It's just stupid. But
listen, I gotta laugh at these guys because it's just what it is. It proves my point. If you're a knucklehead, you're gonna be a knucklehead. I mean, you know, just it is what it is with them. And you know, listen, I'll say it again. We try to joke around, entertain, tell some stories. If people don't believe the accuracy, then they need to go find out. Go read Forbes magazine. But I'm going to tell you something else. Like I said to the last caller, there's a good two dozen, probably more than that, of us that are friends. We all support each other.
Yeah.
We all help each other. And I tell people, if you're not happy listening here, listen to Anthony Ruggiano talk. Listen to Larry Mazza talk. Listen to my friend Gunner talk. In Detroit, you know, they can listen to other guys, but one thing is we all support each other. So the guys that aren't mad for some reason, I mean, we're not going to stop them from being mad or talk nonsense or talk like a child. If that's how they're going to talk, let them talk that way. I'm not going to keep
you
going back.
You get along with Sammy, okay? You and Sammy are cool?
Right? Yeah, I get along with Sammy. I mean, I didn't agree with what he did by putting Jimmy on his
that's
show.
That's what I mean. I was about to tell you that now. Forget about having, you know,
Jimmy,
you know.
Well, he doesn't know him, and he only put him on because Sammy wanted to show that he's on the hierarchy, and look what happens when he tells a guy to dance, he'll dance. So he put him up there like a good puppy doing tricks for him and kissing his ass. I'm against what he did. I didn't think it was right not to even not write to Jimmy himself, actually. And not that I'm sticking up for Jimmy, but I think you made an imbecile of him and you knew what you were doing. And you know, and Sammy won't be able to do that with Larry Mazza or myself or Bobby Luiz.
No, because
we're a little more intelligent and we're a little more schooled. Mm-hmm. So you know, you got to know what you're doing it. So
you guys got to be more like Mike Francis. He loves everybody. He loves God. He loves everything. Everything's great. You know, he's a love fest. I like him though. He's all right. You know, But that, yeah, listen, I'll let you guys go. I appreciate
it. Thank you. Thanks a lot. Hey, and one last thing. You know, guys have been asking, I don't know if you did, they want to know why we wear these headphones, me and Felix. So
no, I have them on right now. I like Bose. I have the Bose Quiet Comfort headphones, so they've got clear eyes down.
No, we're taking flying lessons. We're playing. So we're trying to get used to. Yeah, we're trying to get used to these things. So we wear them on the show.
I can see Felix on a plane with the headphones on, being real calm. John, we're about to go down, but it's going to be all right.
Yeah, he's very calm. He goes, John, don't worry. I brought parachutes for you guys. All right.
That's fine.
Hey, really nice to meet you, Frank.
Hey, thank you so much, and we appreciate you.
You're moving up in the world, Phil. So, you know, you might have to give more money now that I told you that. But
he's got all the money. He only pays me a little at a time. He knows I spend it too fast.
Hey, he's got a good bodyguard. He's got a good bodyguard, too. Sure.
Yeah. Thank you so much. Take care,
buddy. Bye-bye. Thank you.
Hey, everybody out there. For people that don't know, I have a Patreon channel that you can subscribe to, please. And we'll talk about content that is not out on YouTube. It's exclusive. We'll cover Q&A on a regular basis once a month. We sell my baseball bats and they're autographed. And we will talk about content that you won't hear anywhere else but here on Patreon. Thank you, everybody. Please reach out and subscribe. Thank you.
Okay, now we're just going to do a few questions from people that were not able to call in that left a question. Our first person is Nathan. He's been a patron for 8 months, so we thank you for the support. He is asking if you know Phil Baroni, and he actually says precisely, is the Phil Baroni fellow you ran with that was a detective related to a guy that does MMA? There's a pro fighter named Phil Baroni who's from Jersey or New York, and I wasn't sure if there's a coincidence or if they're related. Maybe the fighters are, or maybe the fighter is his son or something.
Yeah, Phil Baroni, that you're talking, is a good question, actually. Phil Baroni, you talk about the father lived around the corner from me on Jamaica Avenue and Forest Parkway in Woodhaven, that I nicknamed Death Haven. His father was a detective. He was involved with me in the drug business, bookmaking business, armed robberies, and a murder. So, yeah, that is the same father. Later on, I moved to Cherry Hill, New Jersey, and Phil Baroni, the detective, followed me to Jersey, and he lived across the street from me. So he was my partner in most all my businesses and crimes. He's actually the one that gave me the information through Joe Coffey, that was also very friendly, was a cop that just passed away. Whether Joe gave that information wittingly or willingly or not, I'm not sure. But Phil gave it to me, that I gave it to John Gotti Sr., that he was going to get locked up for that case. They gave him a life sentence in 90. So that it was Phil Baroni that gave me that information. People know it. The son is Phil Baroni, the fighter. I don't know if he was UFC, but he was a fighter for MMA, UFC, or one of them. He lived with me also for a short period of time. I took him in because he wasn't getting along with his dad. I liked the son a lot. He had a struggling life. The father, in my opinion, left him out there and really hasn't done right by him over the years. And Phil has struggled back and forth, the son, getting his life right. And, you know, I think he named himself the New York Badass. I think he fought under that. But yeah, I took him in at about 16 years old, and I tried to help him out and get him on track. And I really don't know what happened to him after that. But Phil's a good kid, tough kid, strong. And his father, you know, I was very friendly with him. And obviously, we have our differences because of what happened and the case. And, you know, we had a good friendship at one time. So I'm not going to badmouth him, you know, just going to say, leave it at that. We went our own way. We have differences. And I didn't agree with a lot of his ways at all. And I don't think he was a true friend back to me when I needed him. And the son, I wish him well. But they are father and son. The father lives in Vegas now, I believe.
Thank you for that question again. Thank you for being a very long-time subscriber to the Patreon. We appreciate you. Our next question is from Bama, who I believe is a recent subscriber, who's asking about the he basically says we're talking about the Sammy the Bull tapes when he first gets, I think, out of jail, and he talks about you, that we're actually going to be releasing definitely at least first on the Patreon, to be decided if it'll be on YouTube at any point in time, but while you're seeing this, it might actually already be out, so stay tuned for that. But we appreciate you subscribing to the Patreon. A question from Na, or maybe that's initials, who's been a patron for 9 months. who left a question. First of all, we got to thank you. 9 months is a long time. Right. Because we've been doing this show for about a year, so yeah. We appreciate your long-time support. Can you ask John to tell a story about getting arrested with John Gotti Jr. for getting into a fight back in the 90s, and who and why and who they were fighting were never heard of, but if you could tell that story.
We were in a boat called Not Guilty, which was John Gotti Sr.'s boat. John Gotti Sr. was partners with Carlo that owned a restaurant on 71st and 72nd Street on 1st Avenue called The Noise. Carlo was wearing a lot of chains around his neck. His father used to joke and call him the Italian swine because of his accent, and he was like a womanizer and nice guy, Carlos. And we got off the boat. We went to Channel 80. My friend Roger Pasile, his father, Frank, and his brother Frank. I think both Franks passed away since then. We always used to go to the club. Roger was a personal friend. And we got off the boat. We were walking. Everybody was drinking. And John actually, Jr. wasn't involved in the actual fight, for the people that don't know. He did get arrested. And Carlo walked past three or four off-duty police officers that were drunk. And one of them grabbed Carlo by the arm, was making fun of him with his chains. I jumped in when Carlo came to get me. I wasn't actually there. It was a couple feet away, about 15, 20 feet away, and told me he had a problem. I said, with who? And he said, with the guy. And I went over to the guy back and forth, and I ended up hitting him, and the fight carried out to the parking lot. When I was out in the parking lot, one of the guys that jumped in on my behalf was a guy that stayed with me at the time, Steve, and another guy, Richie. Richie was a boxer also. We were in the same gym back in those days. And another guy, Andrew, we used to call him Karate Andrew. He wasn't there, Andrew, but all of us were all guys in the gym, and we were fighting neighborhood guys. And we end up hurting. Richie hurt his guy, and I hurt the guy I was fighting. And they said I cracked his head on afterwards, after the fight, when he was down, I cracked his head on a curb. I'll tell you the truth, I don't know if I did or didn't, it doesn't matter. But they didn't know who we were. And at that fight, I was wearing a gold necklace. Somebody found it, a gold chain around my wrist, and not necklace, and bracelet. And somebody mailed it back to me in the interim, and I don't know if the cops took it. And they made a story it was over a woman. It had nothing to do with a woman. It had to do with abusing Carlo because they knew he came off the boat. They didn't realize it was Gotti's boat. They didn't realize who we were. And they certainly didn't realize Gotti Jr. was there. And when the police showed up, they arrested us all. And Gotti Jr. was upstairs inside the club. They locked him up also. We fought the incident. And Michael Correa was our attorney at the time. Later on, he gets locked up for a heroin business with Gotti, Jeannie Gotti, Johnny Koenig, Angelo Ruggiero, Mark Ryder in a heroin swoop. But the case went away, it disappeared. And the police obviously reached out to us and intermediaries for investigators and lawyers said, we had no idea who you were. And they didn't realize that, you know, 20 different cop cars would show up and it would hit the newspapers and the media like that because they thought we were just regular guys. And that's where that story went for the you guys that are interested.
Perfect. Again, thank you so much for reaching out and leaving that question. Our next one is just Hank, who just has a comment. Hank Noon, shout out to Hank Noon, who I believe just signed up for a year. So we're happy to have you on board.
Thank you, Hank.
Good on you for the Brownsville episode. Thank you. It's a great episode.
I didn't know that was out. It's out.
Yeah, we put on the Patreon. They always get things early.
I hope you guys liked it.
Yeah, it's a great episode with great people. So we're happy that you enjoyed it. Our next one is from Angie Zafirio, a very, very long time loyal listener of the show who unfortunately couldn't call in today, but left us a few questions. So again, Angie, thank you as always for your long time support. I would like to follow up from the last Q&A and say that if I'm ever near New York or New Jersey, I would love to meet up with John, of course. She also has two questions. First, do you plan on having Mike Dowd back on the show?
Well, let me just go back and say about the Brownsville thing. Dan has a great heart for the people who don't know. I don't know how we came off and we opened it. He's a gentleman. He really tries to help not just that community, other
Dan
communities.
Dan and Mike, both of them.
Yeah, and Mike, Mike I met twice, actually. But Dan I'm very friendly with for a while. And Mike's a hell of a guy, a nice guy. So for those people that don't know them, they do help every community. So it's a big deal to have him on, and really, I love the guys. And it's important to me what they're doing, trying to help the younger guys, as what we're trying to do to stare everybody off the street. But Angie's question was...
Mike Dowd, are we going to have
Mike,
him back?
Mike Dowd and me are personal friends. We talk to each other constantly. And yeah, we'll have him back eventually, without a doubt. I mean, I love Mike. He's
entertaining. And you know, we actually, I was thinking, we also have... I think we had never actually released the full video episode because at that point in time, for X, Y, and Z reasons, we're only releasing half the shows on YouTube. So I think if I have it, we'll put up the whole thing, maybe just for your Patreon guys. So that would be fun. How long does John plan on having the podcast?
I just had a heart problem, but I'm back. So we're going to have it for a while. Unless I'm not here, then Felix will have it. But yeah, we're not going anywhere. You know, we have fun with it. It's a good message, and we enjoy it. And hopefully you guys enjoy it. So we're not going anywhere anytime soon.
We also have a very long time loyal subscriber of the Patreon who goes by Joey Yanks Coco. I hope I didn't butcher that. He's been a subscriber for 9 months, which we really appreciate. So thank you for that long time support. And he was basically writing how, you know, I'll read the whole thing because it's a really good story. I actually read this before he came on. Hey, John, how are you? My name is Joey. I've been following your show for a while now. We actually know a lot of mutual people. I was watching the podcast you put up on policing the inner cities a couple days back. I own a pizzeria in Brownsville. My aunt and uncle opened up the pizzeria in 1973 on Pitkin Avenue, Napoli Pizza, and then moved the shop to Rockaway and Livonia in 1981. We have been at this location since then. I bought the shop from them 2 years ago. Like yourself, I think it's really important to give back to the kids and truly believe in all kids, especially the ones in this area that need positive role models. The Brownsville area has very little, if any, Little League programs. I came up with an idea about 6 months ago to organize a Little League program. My original plan was to do baseball, but after talking to a lot of people in the area about it, they all thought basketball would be more appealing. I have sat with quite a few people in the community trying to organize a Little League program for the kids, and I'm not getting so far. I've distributed flyers, set up times and dates for registration. I'm not having a lot of luck. I come from the nightlife industry originally, so I'm confident in my marketing skills, but I'm finding this to be a lot more challenging. People from the community that I'm dealing with are also not having a lot of luck either. After watching your podcast the other day, I saw that Dan and Mike seem like really great guys and know the area very well, and it occurred to me that maybe they would be able to point me in the right direction to give them some advice on how to move forward. I believe my uncle knows both of them. As I mentioned earlier, my aunt and uncle were in the community for over 50 years, and everyone knows them. My uncle, unfortunately, is getting older, and it's sometimes difficult for him to comprehend things. Is there any way you could point me in the right direction on contacting them or having them contact me? Now, just so you know, I did send him Dan's number. And we have gone back a few times. But I think this is just a great example of, first of all, people doing great work, people with great intentions. And, you know, curious to hear your take. And I'm happy that, you know, this is why we do the show.
Hey, I grew up on Jamaica Avenue, so I know what it is to be in those neighborhoods. And one of the biggest things that I'm really pushing is, and I got involved with the assemblywoman that just won. And I also told her the same thing when I met with her, and people seen pictures up on my Instagram and Facebook, that anything that you guys do is really makes us here as a team happy that you're trying to help, because that's really what we're trying to do, get a message out. This isn't about us. It's about the younger generation not to end up like how I was. And examples of what you're doing and what Felix is doing on the show with me is to make sure that the next kid has a chance at life. And the problem is a lot of the kids just think our little communities is the whole world because they financially can't get out of there or they haven't been exposed to it. And every little thing that you're trying to do and Dan's doing and hopefully what we're doing will expand those horizons of those young kids and make them understand that there's other states, other cities, other countries, and a whole world that don't waste it in trouble on the street or in prison or, God forbid, lose your life. So, you know, thank you again for doing that. And anybody else that's listening, whatever we can do to help you expand on any of your ideas, we're here to help you. So thanks again.
Thank you. And that concludes all the questions that we have from our Patreon family. Again, thank you guys for supporting, subscribing to the Patreon. You know, it's a great way to get involved and to talk to you guys and get to know who supports us. And also, I mean, you know, I talked to you a little bit off air about other things that we want to look to do. To expand our Patreon family, yeah. And maybe potentially live podcasts one day and meet and greets and stuff like that. So subscribing to the Patreon helps make all of that possible. So thank you guys again.
Thank you, everybody. Appreciate it.